Good morning. Welcome to today's webinar. Today's webinars are sponsored by Hotchkiss Insurance and are worth one CEU each. To obtain the CEU, visit tnlaonline.org and click on the webinars page or select the certification tab located under the Programs and Events section to download the CEU form. We are listening today with our friends from McFarlin Stanford. Today's webinar is kicking off 2020, Baseline Your Team Now to set the tone for the year. McFarlin Stanford is a dynamic team of green industry business coaches with international and domestic experience in C-level management from Fortune 100 to small entrepreneurial organizations. We are recognized for the dramatically increasing sales volume and profitability through implementing exemplary business process, strategy, and development of loyal teams. During this webinar, you can ask questions using the controls on the right side of the screen, and we will answer them at the end of the webinar as well. So save those questions because some of them may get answered throughout the webinar. Now, here are our friends from McFarlin Stanford.
Hello, Jason New here, and I have Jim Calli with me today. We're happy to present you, I guess, looking at just an introduction to myself, for those of you that don't know me. So McFarlin Stanford, Jason New, I run the operations and leadership practice for our firm as an executive coach, one of the founders of our business. And we help green industry professionals, not only in Texas, but throughout the country, grow their companies and work on the day-to-day business practices that will help them achieve where they want to be. And especially today, we're talking about the team and what we're doing to kick off the things in the right space. So we're excited to share with you today some of our experiences throughout the years and helping you look at your year 2020 to make it more successful than the previous years. So without further ado, let me introduce my business partner, Jim Calli.
Hello, everybody. Excited to be here today. Sitting alongside Jason, talking to you about baselining for 2020. Been in the industry now for 12 years, but I'm much older than that. But excited to help all of you on the call, as well as all of our other coaching clients, think about communication in 2020 and how to share the ulcer of sorts, just to make sure that we're all on the same page, because we can't do it alone. It all starts with communication. So before we get on to where we're at for 2020, we always recap from our last webinar. We handled vendor and subcontractor management for a true partnership. And it doesn't make a difference whether you are a landscaper or a nurseryman, you know, understanding and whether you're what role you are in that subcontractor position, forming and bonding through relationships, through agreements where you lay out the expectations for that role are very important. Just understanding the expectations on both sides of the relationship, the key contacts for those relationships, meaning which individual on each side of the relationship is responsible for that partnership, especially those, I would say, in the top 10. If you're a top 10 vendor for somebody, or you have your top 10 vendors, bonding and understanding what business means to each other in that relationship are very important. Having that relationship will drive the clear expectations, which is the next line. It'll also help you with standardized pricing, so there's no questions about where that happens to be. I will tell you that forming partnerships with subcontractors upside and backside will only drive an opportunity for growth, because essentially a subcontractor becomes a sales arm for let's say a green industry provider, and vice versa. If you're a nurseryman, you can be that to help drive their relationships and grow their business too, the true partner. Utilizing subcontractors for team training. Years ago in Dallas, we were partners with the Arboretum, and there was no better partner to have than to help train through that partnership with the Arboretum, and the value that we both brought to the relationship. We taught them on the other side, but how you truly take this out to the commercial and residential sector. We learned a ton together. Last but not least, you can have relationships, but if you don't have date night, I'm just joking, annual reviews, but if you don't put a line in the sand that once a year, at least you're gonna get together, talk about how much has been spent, both sides of that equation, what the opportunities are to improve, and lastly, how you can improve your businesses together, you're really missing out on an opportunity. So even though that's the last bullet point, I'll tell you, if you mess up all the others, you have a key relationship and just get together once a year and talk about the business, you'll be better than you were before. So that's a recap of last month's webinar, and we're going to move on.
Well, let's make sure it's moving. There we go. Kicking off 2020. So let's talk about how we're going to baseline and how we're going to set our teams up for success. First of all, as we all look at this, you know, one of the ways that we see this as a prime example is the State of the Union. So we're looking at President of the United States. They do a State of the Union speech. Why do they do this? Why do we hear this year after year? What are we doing for the next year?
Right? And what month is it in?
And what month is that?
It's January.
It's January. It's beginning of the season, right?
Exactly.
Well, there's a primary reason why we do this, or that the President of the United States does this. It's an update. Where we are as a country, where we are since we've spoken last. You know, here's some of the great things that we looked at as far as expressing a vision of importance and the current items that we're working on and the challenges we're facing. Not only the challenges that we're facing, the great accomplishments that their, you know, team and that our country has faced and overcome. And so it's an inspirational moment. It's a way for our team to rally around things and our country to rally around things. It's also to go, you know, face the truth on some things we're struggling with. And so in a lot of ways, it's our update.
It's a communication piece.
Yeah. And then where are we going?
So how do you take that ideology and move it to landscaping, or nursery, or anything else for that matter?
You know, that's a great question, Jim. I mean, a lot of ways we move really quickly in our companies. And as this economy is strong and we continue to grow, sometimes we don't take the time. We don't spend the adequate amount of time with our teams discussing what we're doing and what's going on. And we're just moving fast through those moments. And we miss these opportunities.
And I don't care whether you're the CEO, you're an accountant on the finance team. All levels of an organization, communication up and down are key. And using the ideology of a State of the Union is a great place to start. So let's move on here and take it to what we do, right?
So how does this apply? Ways for us to give clear direction to our team and what we're working on, what's important to us as a business owner, what's important to us in leadership, getting some feedback perhaps on some things the team can help with, right? We could celebrate. There's so many times and throughout the year that we've talked about team culture and past webinars, we've talked about how to build, you know, and recognize teams. This is a prime opportunity to really call on people who have been successfully, have helped the company grow and done significant things for you. And we tell ourselves all the time, we're really quick to point out the issues for when people are making mistakes, but we don't really point out when they're doing well. This is our chance.
Well, we're really good critics. Otherwise, they're just doing their job, right? It doesn't work that way. I mean, honestly, if they're doing their job, and then there are people that take a step back and say, if they're just doing their job, why are we going to pat them on the back? Mm-hmm. The same reason you tell your kid or your family member, nice job, right?
Exactly.
You know, the steadiness of the positive reinforcement will only do what? Get more positive things happening in our minds, right?
You got it. And then sharing the ulcer. Obviously, if there are things that are holding us back, that are bottlenecks, are keeping our company from being profitable or growth in the right services that we want to grow in, get some help. Talk out loud about what we can do as a team to overcome those things.
Well, we're regularly asked, you know, we've been asked over the years consistently, you know, I'm having a challenging quarter. I don't need the team to do that. I don't need them to worry about our ability to make payroll. That's actually very common when it comes out of their mouth, is to make payroll. Although, I gotta tell you, we meet very few people who can't make payroll, but you know, they're gonna look elsewhere for another job. They're worried about a more stable, you know, in organization. If you're building the right culture and you're communicating the right way, if you don't share those financial hardships, you really are losing an opportunity for your team to rally. It's amazing when people understand what's going on, what the challenges happen to be, and how they can make a difference and truly shine. It gives them an opportunity from a competitive standpoint to really step up and help you. They can make a difference. You know, they may be buying gloves in bulk, but if they understand the financial ramifications of maybe they should just buy two sets to get us through the end of the year as opposed to the alternative, they're generally smart enough to only buy the two sets of gloves to begin with. So, but when we fall on that matter, it's because of lack of communication, truly losing the opportunity to not share. Share where you're having challenges. The team will rally. I've not seen a team yet rally, and I've never seen anybody quit over sharing a financial hardship inside of an organization.
We're going to give you some examples as we go through this webinar today of how we're going to do that. Okay, so first of all, there are three ways that we're going to talk about today. There are many other ways to do this, but we're going to focus on these three. Holiday party company meeting, a letter to the team.
That's true.
And so many of you are in the midst of that season right now. Holiday party, as we dive into that, maybe you've already had the holiday party. Okay, we'll reflect on it for the next time we get together as a team and understand how you might approach this differently. But if you haven't had your holiday party yet, and some of you are having it this coming weekend, perhaps maybe you're staying until doing it in January. I see a lot of people now doing a holiday party potentially after, as it's less busy.
I'm going to be more direct. If you've already had your holiday party, you don't have to do this when you can worry about it next year, but you need to send a letter to the team.
Absolutely.
So there's no hall pass. If you've done your holiday party and haven't had an opportunity to communicate, you still can get your hands around a letter to the team in January to get this movement started.
Well, and truth be told, all three of these things you need to be doing. Okay, holiday party. We're addressing this in a speech. This is a verbal way to get our recognition of team members and saying thank you. And as we start looking at this, you know, what are some things we can talk about for a holiday party? First of all, do people show up? If you're having a group meeting or a holiday party in your office party and you're getting low attendance or you're getting half attendance or you're getting the vibe that I just don't feel like my team really appreciates the holiday party, so we do it anyways. But at the same time, this is something that we have to do something to make this a better experience, right? So how do we make it a better experience? We make it fun. If you look at this photo right here, this is a movie where a guy is dressing up on stage. There's loud music. He's yelling to the fans, to his team and his office party, who's having a lot of fun. And he's getting the troops and the team rallied around having fun. And in this moment, he's talking about how great they are. And he's recognizing people and he's recognizing team members and he's calling people out and saying what they've meant to him and what they've meant to the company and how he couldn't be here without them. That's a pretty powerful way to address people as far as a speech.
I'll tell you, it's self-fulfilling. You know, if you get up in front of the group and say, listen, we're the best nursery in Waco, and this is the best place to be. Even if you Debbie doubt yourself, if you start using that language, you'll start getting yourself there, right? Mm-hmm. So that speech, and I hate the word speech. People get a pit in their stomach when they hear the word speech. This is just what needs to be done from a leadership perspective. I don't care whether it's departmental or whether it's the head of the company. You know, recognizing to your point and self-fulfilling to how we feel about ourselves and where we're going as an organization will start to build the momentum, especially because you're communicating about things you probably never communicated about to begin with, right?
Absolutely.
Hey, Jason, can you guys make sure that your screen is showing? I know you guys have a PowerPoint slide deck, and I just want to make sure everybody else can see it.
Oh, my goodness. It's not showing?
I don't see it. I'm so sorry.
Yeah, thank you for chiming in. I thought this was being presented the whole time, so let's get this going.
You missed some really good slides.
I know. We may need to, let's see. Share my, no, that. Let's see. We want to show. Yes.
There you go.
So
you're
sorry.
Live. Thanks.
I thought we were already live. Boy,
I'm
howdy.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah. So, yes. Okay. Well, we've gotten through State of the Union. We've gotten through, by the way, this was a fun photo. This is when everybody's happy. I've got to show this slide. We worked hard to find at least the president speaking with everybody happy behind him. So there we go. Moved on
happy.
Past that.
Moving the right direction.
Let's go into, this is where we are at the holiday party. And briefly speaking about the holiday party, what are some ways we made it fun, Jim? What are some traditions we did just to give people an idea of, if they haven't done their holiday party this year and they can still plan for some fun, what did we do as far as our experience?
It's addressing everybody, right? And I would tell you that a holiday party at the end of the day should be more than just the team. First of all, if you can involve spouses, awesome. If you can involve the kids, even better. And what we're doing is we're trying to build a support team for your team member, for the role that they're in, the place they work. I mean, I can tell you in the green industry, it's not easy. And so when they work those long days or they're in the heat of the season, if you've shared your vision and shared your thank yous in front of not only spouses, potentially kids, there will build a respect around your organization as a whole. And, you know, it's an investment. I got to tell you, it's an investment. But I got to tell you, the best investment is one that you spend money on that you know you're going to get a return on. If you create an ambiance through a party, be it maybe you do the spring fling or you can do something else where you take a moment to step back, share the values of the organization, where it's going, you'll get a whole different set of believers. I can tell you, for years I've talked to direct reports of mine and talked to them about how big their team is. And when they sell it, tell me they've got 10 direct reports or 5 direct reports, I would tell you it's a lot more than 5. You've got 5 direct reports, you've got a spouse, you've got 2.3 kids, and who knows what you've got beyond that somebody may be supporting. So, you know, whereas the team members are ultimately that most important, rallying around bigger a bigger audience, yep, in the reflection period of where you are as an entity, is very important. We always made the kids would get Christmas gifts and they had to sit on Santa's lap. So if you were 17 and wanted a gift, you got a gift, but you had to take a picture with Santa. So that's a tradition. But I can tell you from a tradition perspective, to getting together and sharing the words, whether, like I said before, departmental or company-wide, build a tradition around thanks and appreciation and communication. Now, we've talked about sharing financial information and things like that too. I certainly wouldn't do that during the holiday party. So I take a step back from that. I mean, if you're only doing your team, then maybe you might want to do that at the office or something like that. But as we take it beyond that, I certainly would take a step back from the financial side of it and wait for that to be more of a personal setting with only team members, okay?
Holiday party, looking at awards.
I love that. I'm glad we have the pictures up now.
Yes. So looking at awards, I mean, there are several things that we look at that we can, if we're recognizing and they're empty as far as what we're thanking people for, you know, you can only say so much. But if you actually are tracking things, measuring things throughout the year, why not recognize team members that have done a tremendous job for you? So I see, you know, here's a funny medal that shows an ugly sweater first place 2019. That could be fun. That's a fun new little thing you could do just for the party. Right. But think about what you could do inside your team if you recognized a top salesperson, someone who's really done a tremendous job of helping us in sales. You're, you know, a top operational person, a team member of the year, a team member, you know, that has done a significant thing in their first year. So one of your early rising stars. If you can measure things inside your organization and you are tracking that, then you can actually go into these meetings in front of their spouses, in front of their kids, and recognize somebody meaningfully saying that they've got, you've got results and you want to recognize them. We've seen a few in LinkedIn, if you see a few in companies around here that are experiencing this right now in their holiday party. I love the golden pruners of the year. You know, those are some great examples. And of course, what Jim talked about is the vision, right? Casting a vision of where we're going to be next year. So let's go into, dive into the company meeting where you can be a little more forthcoming as far as sharing the financials that Jim mentioned earlier, but also just be more detailed in your visual. You're celebrating team members and recognizing people there, right? Here's some examples. Jim, what is this an example of? What are we doing here?
Well, that's me on the right. I'm short, much shorter than Andy Nelson. And that's a joke. I'm actually the guy on the left. So this is myself passing out the Jim Calli Award. We work with a bunch of peer groups, and we have brought five peer groups together in Quebec City last month. And recognizing the team that most represents us and the values that we have. And my award's always based on teams. Jason's award's always based on profit. And just taking a moment back and having some fun with the awards. I don't know if you can tell, but that's a cutout of me from a picture that I sent to Etsy, and they can put some nice words on the bottom of it. It's going to sit on the bookshelf for a while. But think how you can utilize that inside of your own organization. I mean, you've seen us, you know, putting Santa Claus from a movie, having fun. And right here, you see us putting that into action of us smiling and having some fun with people that really meant a difference to us. And that will go long beyond that. It'll inspire them past that moment. Mm-hmm. And you're making memories. This is not just a report and you're moving on. So the awards piece of that you mentioned and how you tie that together, this would be an excellent way to do so.
Absolutely. So it again, tied back to things that you're measuring, metrics. If Jim's specifically talking about a company that's done a tremendous job as far as their growth, most improved. So we measured sales and we've measured their profitability both. And they said they're the most overall improved. You know, I'm giving out an award for most profitable. We measured this against several other companies. And this guy did a tremendous job being the most profitable. And this is meaningful things that we can recognize people for. So reviewing the goals this year, accomplishments, financials, open book financials. We found in our experiences in a company meeting, this is the right format for it. So if you're going to show a trend within bar charts or within numbers, and you're sharing that now, this is the proper way to do it. Everyone wants to see how well we did as a company. If you're not sharing these financials, we would love to, you know, discuss that with you offline, and you could call us directly or email us. But this is an important part of helping people realize how they can contribute. These are some examples of how people have done that inside of a company meeting.
Let's share financials and eat pizza.
That's right. I mean, if you're setting a tone, right? If we're going to do something in 2020 different than we did in 2019, what does that mean? Like if we're just talking out loud, we're all verbal and it's all just, you know, 10,000 foot level, big picture stuff. they, you know, your team does not know what they're doing to be able to help you get there.
So communication through the company meeting, you'll see the picture over on the right that's actually working with a team to grab some goals for the following year. That's the picture from a little ways back. But, you know, interacting with the team through these company meetings, getting their feedback on where you are and where you're going, capturing those points. A great exercise that we would encourage a lot of people to do is through this company meeting, if you're looking for interaction, is to ask them to categorize one item for each of the following three categories. We need you to pick one item that we need to keep doing, one we need to start doing, and one we need to stop doing, right? Mm-hmm. And if you can capture that information, the start, stop, and keep on white marker boards, just like this around the room, you'll be impressed what you come up with. You're gonna find duplicates. And by the way, what does a duplicate mean? That's a great thing. That means probably a priority that you need to work on. So a start, stop, keep exercise with your teams through this company meeting exercise really will get the brain go in the right direction. Everything starts cranking and the feedback that you will get will be priceless.
And the key component of this is interaction. It's not one person. It's not the leader of this, you know, of the company doing all the talking. It's discussion.
And then out of that start, stop, keep, what can we get?
Our goals for 2020.
Ding, 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 ding.
You know, so let's write it down. What are we going to accomplish? How are we going to accomplish it? Who is going to help us make that happen? What are the resources needed for us to make that happen? Let's put a plan in place on tackling these things and a timeline and put some deadlines to it so that we're approaching this in a way where we know where we're going. So these aren't just goals where it's one line saying, hey, we want to grow 20%. Hey, we want to be somewhere, you know, we want to add on tree service, or we want to add this new product line to our nursery business. It's okay. What are we going to dedicate as far as time, resources, and contribute the people that are going to be involved to make that happen?
And if you haven't chosen to figure out what your theme for 2020 is, I'm going to be the biggest dork here. We're going to have a clear vision in 2020, right? You know, 2020 vision, we're going to know where we're going. So just go ahead, capture it. I guarantee you can probably find 2020 clear vision stuff on Amazon.com to hang around your office. I mean, this is the time to talk about the vision. You've even got a saying for the year, and you didn't have to work that hard for it. So you utilize that through the company meeting to get you guys going to the next level.
Absolutely. All right. And one of the most powerful pieces we're going to talk to you about today is how do you make this happen in writing? How do you put this out there so that it's not only something we've talked about, it's something that we've put a thought into, we've written on paper, and we're sending this message out to the entire team. Something for the spouses to read, something for the team to read, something that you can hold back and actually review again and again and again to make sure you're staying on track with what it is that you're trying to do. In this letter, our experience says that as we're telling a story. We're telling a story about our company, where we've been, where we are today, and where we're going. So we format this in a past, present, and future type of a format so that you can get your message across the right way and tell a story through this letter. And this takes some effort. This takes some thought. But doing the company meeting, holiday meeting to a company meeting, at this point, you've got all the critical details. You've got the stuff that's out there. Now you've got to get it on paper. So here's an example of telling a story of the past, right? So we've got a company that is founded in 1992. It's 27th year in business this year in 2019. We provide a high-end, you know, landscape service or nursery business or tree service, whatever it is that your business provides, right? You call it out. You're very specific on what that is, and you're like, very excited to be in our 27th year. You know, previously, let's talk about the past. In 2018, we had a rough year. You know, we potentially didn't have the sales we were looking for. We were stagnant. We were looking for changes, and we just didn't have it. You know, where our competition was growing, we felt like they were doing really well. We were still doing the same things, and we were chasing ourselves around. That was our change moment. We needed to make some change happen, right? We were shorthanded. We couldn't produce all the work that was there in front of us. Our equipment was breaking down. We were really down in sales. Be as specific as you want. These are just highlights on what you would cover. And changes were needed, so we're going to actually set some goals up for 2019, right?
We did set goals up, right?
Yep.
So we got it. And then, wow, look what we did.
And 2019, here we go. We tracked it. We started here and there with 39% increase in our sales. We've hired 9 new team members. Name them out in your letter. Here are the new team members. We're celebrating milestone anniversaries with these team members and name them, our 1 year, 5 year, 10 year. You see the trend in that scenario. The new equipment that we purchased that has helped us in our productivity, because so we were, even though we may have been a little shorthanded, even though we've hired 9 new team members, we added this equipment to support our growth and to help us achieve what we're trying to get installed or inside of our nursery business, move faster. This is the innovative startup, pieces of what we do in our company. We won some awards. We went to TNLA, we entered awards, and this is the awards we won this past year. Very excited to participate in that and recognize the people involved.
And just a little aside on that one, the TNLA awards are super awesome for your team. And the reason for that is they really are not about you, whether you're running the company or leading a team. It's about acknowledgement of the work they're doing on a scale beyond the current organization they're in. And whether you do a TNLA award, I know other people have applied for awards with like the local chamber of commerce. I know that some people in Dallas here have won something like the ethics award with like the Dallas Business Journal. There's different awards you certainly can sign up to. And we've had many people tell us, that's a waste of time. It's taking our eye off the ball. But the intention is behind filing for something like that at an award with an organization, it brings credibility to your team that they're doing the right things. It's kind of like at home. If you tell your kids to do a great job, it's one thing. But if somebody else tells them they did a great job, it means the world to them. So it's just acknowledgement outside as the work efforts they're putting forth on behalf of your team are paying off and sets them apart from other companies in the area. So last but not least.
And by the way, something I'd be remiss if I didn't say it and add to it. The certifications. A big part of our team was, and I say our team now and our team then, is we hire young, people that have energy. They're excited about the industry. They need to gain experience, and to be able to be experts in our industry is credibility, right? And so the way we become experts in our industry is to really start going through a certification process. And TNLA offers an incredible certification program. As well as there's some out there in the country that you go on a national level. So in that regard, if there's anyone, if we support certifications and someone has got that, this is a great area to start recognizing people who've gotten certified over the year to maybe inspire other team members to go out and do the same thing. So they can realize, oh my gosh, my coworker, I didn't realize the guy over there in this other department went and got that. That'd be interesting. I'd like to be a CDL driver too.
Yeah, there's so many things that you can put in there. I've seen team member letters put babies that were born that year, acknowledgement of those types of things. I mean, this is the state of the union. I will tell you that, it's great that you can get this across to a party. The letter memorializes it. Our goal would be to get it out before the end of the year, but if you certainly could get out in January, it'd be fun. The companies that we work with, I will tell you that the letter has become a tradition, right? Companies are based on traditions, and actually one of the presentations we're going to be giving at the roundup for TNLA in January in Fort Worth is going to be a whole piece based on traditions. This will become a tradition. People will expect it. It's a communication tradition, and it will take your company far. So move on to the future.
So cast a vision for what the company goals are for next year. Examples would be, what would that be? We want to increase our sales by 25%. We want to make sure that we are looking at what that means. Okay, so if I'm a landscape green industry professional and I do maintenance, I do installation, I do enhancements, this 25% is across the board. That's not detailed enough. So detailed enough may be we want to grow 10% in our maintenance contracts. We want to grow 20% in our enhancement sales. And we're going to grow 5% in our landscape construction business.
In the nursery, it may be contracts for plant material for spring, driving your providers to contract with you based on their contracts that are already in place, be it for color, be it for a large job that be coming. Great way to get these sales pieces that you want to get anyway.
So in a sense where we're looking at not only sales, the opportunities, right? I put in one little tidbit about 2 new crew leaders. We've also seen where this has been a powerful example where we can post where we want to see growth. You know, if we have an organizational chart, or we have a way that we can add new people into our teams, do we display that for our whole team to be excited about it and potentially get involved? Where I go, okay, crew leaders are an opportunity. What if I need a new account manager? How about a new business development representative inside of our teams? If I call this out on the front end of it, that we're going to need these things, what we're going to see is we're going to have people that are show interest, or they may know somebody. But the more that you can speak these things into existence, the more opportunities you have inside your company to know who's interested in pursuing these roles and supporting them in their growth. And this is how you retain your team as well.
So I was going to just take a second and kind of tie all these pieces together in the presentation. That we've just talked about a meeting, be it the holiday party or after the first of the year, you're talking about a start, stop, keep exercise. If you're going to be putting these pieces together and you are going to write a letter to the team, it might behoove you to get through those pieces together, use the letter as a recap to the meeting to do this, where we've been, where we are today, and the vision that you guys have casted now through our meeting is sowing X, okay?
Okay. So adding a new service to our client mix, improvement to their process. So let's go into a list of items that you would be able to run with. Okay.
Now, mind you, if you want to copy this presentation after the fact, last slide of this presentation, it'll give you our email address. So if you're trying to write these down real fast or take pictures, that's fine. But also, if you just want to copy this presentation, if you email us at the end, we'd be more than happy to share this presentation with you.
Absolutely.
So go ahead.
You know, let's run through the list. So sales, we've talked about top sales team member by department, new team members. Let's call them out.
Yeah.
Tenured team member.
Call them out. Yeah. You know, one of the new team member pieces that we've seen recently from one of our clients that's been very successful is they're classifying their team members as a class year. And what I mean by that, if they started in 2014, they would be the class of 14. If they start this year in 2019, they're the class of 2019. I realize some classes will naturally shrink over time because of turnover. Of course, we would be coaching you to not have turnover, but that's inevitable. But thinking through the new team members piece, you can introduce them as the class of 2019, 2020, et cetera. Once again, building another tradition inside of your organization for having some fun at the office.
Mm-hmm. Awards for projects, right? We've talked about that. Promotions. We haven't really discussed the promotions piece. It's exciting to see upward momentum for people who are progressing in the company. So if someone moved from an entry-level position and moved into a management position, let's celebrate that. That speaks volumes to people who want to join your team, and they're young and they're energetic and they say, bring it on. I want to be in that position at some point too. This seems like a company that promotes from within. That sounds pretty incredible. So promotions is really something to call out.
Operational improvements to brag about. Like, what did we do this year? We added, you know, from a landscape company perspective, we added wireless irrigation controllers under our customer properties and what that means and why. Mm-hmm. As we continue to innovate as a company, we innovate in our roles. We all get smarter, better, and things like that. If you're a nursery, the same thing. You could enhance your irrigation systems. You could, you know, take a million different approaches on this, especially with all the equipment we see at Expo every year. Mm-hmm. But bragging about this and making sure that it's just not forgotten. We find that in teams, it's not that you're not, as a leader, doing the right things by your team. It's just they don't realize it. So they don't know what they don't know. Mm-hmm. They don't recognize it because they don't understand what the value is to them ultimately the end of the day. And just telling that story will make a big difference. And, you know, truthfully, the same thing goes for a client. If you don't tell a client what you've done extra, they don't realize it either. So just think about this more of the communication piece, and it's bragging or humble, whatever you want to call it, but just letting people know what you've done, it is a big deal. Top operational teams.
Top operational teams.
What do we do when we used to run a landscape firm? We took the top ops team for each department and we bought them boots.
We sure did.
And we took them off the job site for the day. Not the day, actually, it would be the morning. We'd shop for boots at about 10 a.m. We'd take them to a nice lunch. And those boots, what did those boots represent to them, Jason?
They represented, it was basically something to be proud of.
Yeah.
This is a badge of honor. So we got a chance to get a brand new pair of Red Wing boots.
Yeah.
We got to go shop with our leadership team, and they went with us, had lunch. We took them to lunch. We took them to find the boots. They wore them back, and they're just bragging. I mean, they were proud. How would your team not be proud of that?
Absolutely. So the operational teams by department, that's a fantastic idea. You know, utilizing that information not only internally to build camaraderie around what we're doing and why you want to work hard and why you want to earn the boots in 2020, but from a recruiting standpoint. Traditions, once again, inside of a firm, that we do consistently. It's a communication piece. We reward for the right behaviors, and we acknowledge them, and we do something about it.
Yeah.
Equipment purchases.
Largely, there's so many that you could speak about, but it could be simple things too. We had one year particularly, I remember an experience where we were doing aerating. If you've never aerated, it is a very tedious and it'll beat you up. So it's like a jackhammer that you're walking behind. And as it's punching the ground on very hard soil, it rattles you. I mean, your arms are rattling. And so for years, the team that I was working with at the time said, we've got to do something better. And
go buy a Mercedes.
So we test drove a stand-on aerator.
Like I said, a Mercedes.
Uh-huh. And the stand-on aerator was basically the Mercedes or the Cadillac of it all. Our team leader at that point decided he was going to prove out why we needed it and how it would help us. So he put up a report together, just completely impressive, about how much aeration the company was doing, how much acreage we were covering, the amount of time and hours spent that our crew was performing those aerations, and the fact that if we could do it in half the time, it would save us money by buying this machine. That we would actually be more profitable by buying this machine.
So if you're putting this in the letter to the team, this is one opportunity where not only are you putting a piece in about equipment, you go as far as to sit there and say, listen, this was driven by team member John Doe.
That's right.
The result's been X. And once again, the details. Now, it's before we go through the rest of these bullet points, you know, maybe you're saying to yourself, oh, good God, guys, this letter may be 10 pages. You know what? It may be 10 pages, and that's okay.
Yep.
You know why? Because this is a recognition exercise of what we've done, where we're going, and a communication piece, because you'll never find yourself in a position where you truly can plan your time and actually get something down on a piece of paper and make this happen. I know one CEO, he spends the entire month of December working on this and dabbling through it, right? Mm-hmm. Because he knows how important it is to his team, and he also doesn't want to leave anybody behind who actually truly did do something that needed to be recognized.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, we can go on from that. Goals accomplished and improved our company in 2019. We talked about that. Mm-hmm. Service changes and updates, we actually touched that too. So, last but not least, the metrics. Grew X percent, you know, stayed steady. We, you know, our profits dropped, but this is what we're doing to change things. The more details, not only for the metrics right here that you're talking about in regards to numbers of a company, the more metrics that we put in place in regards to team members and counts, people can get their hands on that.
Mm-hmm.
Having something competitive in nature that they can try and meet or beat an expectation, be it from internally, externally with clients, externally against another competitor, all those pieces will drive a team the places you want to go in 2020. So.
Absolutely. So in regards to this, one thing I have found, once you do the work, once this is put in stone and what you put in place the first year, it's a great template to reuse and repurpose each and every year past that. So do the homework the first time. It gets a lot easier.
Said it too.
So how do I follow up on to make sure the message is received well?
Just send the letter and be done with it. Good Lord, you've spent enough time doing that, Jason. Seriously? you want me to do more?
Well, that's the biggest thing. We spent all this time, effort into the holiday party and making sure, you know, we did our dot our I's, crossed our T's.
With the company planning meeting, we sent a letter now.
So we've got a letter. We put all this effort into it.
Stop talking. Just go do. Why do I need to talk about it again?
I know, right? So it is the follow-up pieces.
Yes.
So let's look at the next piece. What is the follow-up pieces? Timelines and deadlines.
You know, timelines and deadlines, you may look at that, that's the same thing. I think all of us would, you know, need to understand the difference between timeline and deadline. There's a great book called Winning with Accountability that's a short read of about 120 pages that you can read with yourself or your team. Once again, Winning with Accountability. And it describes the differences of timelines and deadlines. And the difference between a timeline and a deadline is this. A timeline is an expectation. A deadline is just a line in the sand that has to be met. And as leaders and organizations, we typically talk in terms of deadlines, but the reality is they are timelines. And you want to know why I know the difference? If it was a deadline and a team member didn't meet a deadline, you as the leader would be doing it for them to meet the deadline, because we don't miss deadlines, right? Timelines are directives in regards to making sure that we are on the right track to hit goals inside of an organization. But if you're not going to hit them, at least you can acknowledge them, move it on, redirect, maybe plan time differently and get it done. But if you really truly are using deadlines, in my mind, if a deadline's not being met, the leader's going to make sure it gets done. So think through that, timelines and deadlines, and the acknowledgement piece past the meeting, the annual party, the meeting, the planning meeting, and the letter is, how are we going to get those things done in the future that we've discussed? So think about how you get that done. So when you do this again at the end of 2020, and we're having the same conversation again, you can make sure you get more done, because timelines and deadlines build momentum, and momentum will get stuff done.
And so how do you make sure that these timelines and deadlines are being reviewed and looked at? So one-on-one meetings, we've talked about these things. We've talked about this specifically and other items in this timeline deadline piece in previous webinars. So if you want to look at previous webinars, I know TNLA stores these so that you can have access to them. One-on-one meetings is a structured way for you to work on a one-hour committed meeting every single week with your direct report, so that you can look at these things. You can look at our goals and review if we're on our timeline, if we're hitting those timelines, if we're going to hit our deadline, or if we need to work, you know, extra hours or some extra time and get some other resources.
Might even use the 1 hour of the one-on-one to get it done, because you're utilizing that timeline to get some things done.
You're right. So this one-on-one meeting is a dedicated amount of time that you're spending with each direct report, that after you spend all this time and energy on saying, here's the vision for 2020, that we're actually doing it. We're actually following up and ensuring that we're moving forward and making progress, right? And then, and team meetings. Team meetings are for updates. Where are we with this? Who is doing well? Who's doing not? How can we help with other resources and the different parts of it? So it's not only the day-to-day pieces. The day-to-day pieces are important, and it's something that you have to do to run the business, right? We're talking about the goals that's going to make yourself different in 2020 and keeping pace on where you want to be. The team meetings are for that. It's where are we with our timelines and deadlines as a group? It's where do we, all of us contribute to help in those puzzle pieces in the previous picture that I had there. How do you make that happen? And how do we help each other make that happen? Because if it's a team effort, you're not in it alone, you're sharing that ulcer, it's, you're going to get farther along faster.
No doubt.
So in a review of what we did, quick recap on our baselining the team now to set the tone for the year, we have the State of the Union. We have three ways we've presented today: holiday, party, company meeting, letter to the team. All three of those are needed.
All very valuable. Yep. And all serve their own purpose.
A format in which to share the information. We're telling a story, yep, right? Sharing the ulcer, helping people understand what we're up against.
Sharing the wins.
And sharing the wins.
That's right.
And then setting the goals. And so that we have a good follow-up system to actually make sure those goals are happening.
Yeah, I'll just give you a little tip. If you, anybody ever, the past, present, and future, utilize that in your life as a whole. This is absolutely totally on right here. We're talking about talking to your team. But if you're ever thrown into an awkward position where you need to toast somebody, when you stand in front of the room, just go past, present, and future. That'll get you through any toast or any awkward speech that you've got to give in front of a group. If you start thinking that way, you can get through anything within a 1 or 2 minute span of getting the room rallied around where you're at today. So mm-hmm. Anyway, I know that was point two, but we're moving past that now. All right.
And this is a good time that if anyone is on this webinar, I know that Sarah has been helping us through facilitating this webinar, but she can, you know, questions, things that we can answer for you. And certainly we can send the slideshow, like Jim mentioned earlier. If you want to send us your email address or reach out to us directly, we can send you this.
We've already gotten one email request from somebody who knows us looking for the presentation. So we'll make sure we send that out to you, Bob. So as we're waiting for questions, we'll tell you more opportunities to work with us. We'll be, the monthly management series will continue in 2020. I believe that there'll be a couple less, but we're finalizing that now with TNLA as we speak. We'll be talking at Grow 2020, February 24th to 26th in Charlotte, North Carolina, which is a 3-day landscaping program, primarily driven towards landscapers, I will say that, with a tour of the Loving Company. We're working with new peer groups. Groups will be selected in March in New Orleans. We've got the Education Corral, and we should have moved that up. Sorry about that. That should be right after Grow. We come back from Grow, and the next day we're in Fort Worth working with the TNLA Education Corral, where we'll be handling business topics, and we'll be publicizing what our topics are later this week. And, of course, the annual Nursery Landscape Expo in San Antonio, the 13th and 14th, and then we've got Elite Retreat in Colorado. Sarah, do you have something?
Yes, actually, we do have a question that came in, and it was when you guys were talking about the metrics and the letter to the team and how people are competitive in nature. What yes, are some sure. examples that you can give to drive the team on where you want them to go to get that competitiveness going and flowing?
So the biggest piece of that, depending on what team member it is, yeah. right? So let's start with an operational example. So efficiencies. You know, we track a couple of things in efficiencies on a regular basis in our coaching practice, which just happens to be our budgeted hours. Did we actually hit our budgeted hours versus our actual hours? And so that's an efficiency rating. And our efficiency rating is a big part of whether or not our projects are successful, whether it's landscape construction, whether it's how we're growing a certain material inside of our nurseries. We should have a budget of hours that we are dedicated towards getting our product ready for the end user. And we need to measure that. So it's an efficiency rating. It's how well do we perform against that budget. The second piece to that would be overtime. You know, and a lot of times in our companies, we don't measure overtime. Overtime is a huge factor right now in how competitive we can be in this market and how we can grow in our sales.
And a result of not having team members.
So if we look at major improvements and how we can get the same level of work done and not have to go into an overtime situation, it may be using resources, better equipment, innovative equipment, things like that. So we want to recognize those two things operationally. In sales, same scenario. We've also looked at warranty and callbacks. You know, who had the least amount of warranty? Who had zero warranty? You know, who had zero callbacks this year and helped the company a huge way by not basically doing the work twice? Those are a few examples.
Great. Okay, the next question is, you know, you do this letter to the team, everybody is hyped up and ready to go, but within 6 weeks, you see the team, it starts to lose its luster. How do you continue to keep them motivated to stay on track with timelines?
I would tell you that it's the consistency of the conversation. Great question. So we're keeping them on track. If we hit the letter in place, let's just say by the end of January, and that's 6 weeks later, it is March the 15th in Texas, which means everything's growing. And it is hard to remember those great moments. It's going to be hard to remember if you haven't brought it up since the end of January and it's March 15th and you try and reinstate it. I will tell you the team meeting piece and the consistency of the messaging from the letter through the team meeting piece, meaning, you know, we said this year we were going to work on overtime. Does that mean every single team meeting we've talked about overtime? I would tell you with any team letter, we should work on three goals for the following year, and touching what those three goals happen to be in 2020 and the consistency of the weekly piece. And if you're talking about it weekly, you should be making progress towards that same thing too, because you're holding yourself accountable every single week if you have to bring up a subject. And if you walk into a room in front of your team and every single week you don't have any update to what the goal happened to be, or the team doesn't have an update to it, it gives you an opportunity to have a little guilt in the room, and people get their hands on this and you start seeing action take place. The biggest challenge that we see in any of the firms that we work with is the lack of consistency in the conversation towards goals and getting stuff done. So if you've got a one-on-one and you're talking every single week about the pieces that you finished, the things you're working on, and what you're going to be doing the next couple of weeks, and you constantly visit this stuff every single week, you cannot help but build momentum in your organization with all of your direct reports. It's when you don't have those types of meetings and we just get lost in the Texas heat, and I know somebody's working on this and I can't get my hands on it, that you find yourself at challenges. Now, if anybody's on this call and they're saying to themselves, good Lord, more meetings, I would challenge you like I challenge any leader. Put how many meetings a week you've got on a calendar. Chances are you have between 10 and 15 hours a week of calendar items. If you're working 60 hours a week, that means you're spending less than 25% of your time on truly replicating yourself and making things happen in the business without your assistance. And if you're not spending that 25% of your time doing that, okay, I don't know what you're doing. You're going to continue to be an individual contributor and not make any headway in your organization. So those meetings are key to building more for yourself and to build momentum towards getting stuff done. So there's my answer. I hope that one helps.
All right. Yep. Well, that's all the questions I see on my end. I want to thank both of you very much, and also Hotchkiss Insurance for bringing us today's webinar. Do you guys have anything additional you want to add before we close out for the day?
No, just if anything, reach out to us if we can help in any other way. And we talked about the future events we're going to be at. Of course, we're highly involved in TNLA, but we also do green industry recruiting and bookkeeping for green industry providers less than 5 million. And we're here. Follow us on Facebook, LinkedIn. Those are probably the two biggest ones where we post the most regularly. And we've got content messaging there. So you'll see these little tidbits that have come around. And of course, through the weekly wisdoms through TNLA. Happy to help. Excited to be a part of an industry like this one that truly in Texas is growing like crazy, and people care enough to educate themselves to be better. So appreciate everybody's time and being on here today to earn your CEU.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. This concludes today's webinar.